Our story today is adapted from one of my favorite authors, Leya Lakshmi Pyepsna Samara Sinha, and it is called The Bridge of Flowers. Now, I need you to know that this story is told in the voice of a young girl who loves her family very much. Here we go. I am quiet, and I listen a lot, and that's why I get to tell this story. So here's what happened. My mom, Soraya, is a witch. And that means that she listens to people talk and she makes potions for them out of flowers and dirt and rocks and sometimes even spit to help them with their problems. My papa, Kamau, is a scientist, and they spend a lot of their time looking at tiny pieces of moss under lots of different microscopes. When mom and papa fell in love, they planted two trees close enough together that they could be near each other.
I need it a bit loud. Oh, it's a bit too loud, but I like the monitor. That's awesome. As a flame by the light glowing, show us beauty, vision, and joy. Rise up, O flame, by thy light glowing. Show to us beauty, vision, and joy.
Good morning. Ooh. Good morning. There we go.
Thank you, Sue.
Morning, everyone. Yep. Good morning, everyone. Hearts are worn in this dark ages. You're not alone in this story's pages. Night has fallen amongst the living and the dying, and I'll try to hold it in, yeah, try to hold it in. But the world's on fire, it's more than I can handle. Tap into the water, try to do my share, try to do more, more than I am able. Bring it to the table, bring what I am able. I watch the hands, but I find no calling. Something I can do to change what's coming. Stay close to me while the sky is falling. Don't wanna be left alone. Don't wanna be left alone. The world's on fire, it's more than I can handle. Tap into the water, try to do my share, try to bring more, more than I am able. Bring it to the table, bring what I am able. Visions clash, planes crash, still there's talk of saving souls, still the cold is closing in on us. Ooh, we part the veil on our killer sun. Straight from the straight line on this short run. The more we take, the less we become. The fortune of one man means less for some. And the world's on fire, it's more than I can handle. Tap into the water, try to bring my share, try to bring more than I can handle. Bring it to the table, bring what I am able. The world's on fire, it's more than I can handle. Tap into the water, try to do my share, try to bring more than I can handle. Bring it to the table, bring what I am able. Bring what I'm able.
Nope, there go the glasses. Good morning and welcome to the First Unitarian Church of Hamilton. We welcome you here in the sanctuary, and for those who are joining us online. My name is Tim Versteeg, my pronouns are he, him, and it's my great pleasure to serve this church as its religious educator. I'll be your service leader this morning. We thank the many people who are co-creating our service experience this morning. Our music director, Rachel Derry, our speakers, Reverend Jamie Boyce, and through the magic of video, Dr. Sophia Betancourt. Our tech team, Claire Miles and John Elliott, and our ushers, Angela and Peter Morgan, our worship associates, Sue and Ian Johnstone, and our greeters, Gabby Walker and Rita Mubarak. As always, in our multi-generational services, our CYRE activity cart is available at the front to borrow items to keep young hands and minds active during the service. A vital part of our lives together and our ministries to each other and the world is the sharing of our news in our community. This morning, we have a couple of announcements to share. First of all, make sure to come out if you're able to tonight's New Year's celebration at the church from 5 to 9. We have lots of pizza ordered, and we will be joined together in fellowship with food and also board games, a puzzle table, and a station to create care bags for the unhoused in Hamilton. This is a dry event, so if you want to celebrate New Year's in another way, you'll have to go elsewhere after we're done at 9. Join us for the Zoomers and Boomers Coffee Social on January 3rd, 2024 at 1:30 p.m. in Fellowship Hall. Retired astronomer Dr. Frank will talk to us about our expanding view of the universe. That should be exciting. Anyone over 50 is welcome to attend, even if you've never been to one of our meetings. Check us out and you won't be disappointed. There's Frank. I was looking for Frank so he could put up his hand. Our land acknowledgement. So I've done something a little different. This is more of a reflection on land acknowledgements this morning. And it's somewhat personal. I have a clear memory of being in grade 8 in the early 80s in the northern Swampy Cree community of Pocketawagon. And during a library period, an Indigenous friend of mine, Pete Sinclair, was clearly trying to elicit a response from the two white guys in the room, which were me and the teacher. And he stated that he wished he could get the white guys who killed the buffalo. Now, it was kind of youthful bravado, and it's a sort of uncomplicated statement that only someone in their early teens could make. And I remember saying, well, you know, my people were still living in Holland and England at the time, and I remember the teacher saying that he was from PEI and they never saw any buffalo there. Well, we all probably missed the point, but I'm glad we were all okay with having the conversation. It's become fairly common for white Unitarians and progressive Canadians generally to position themselves as settlers. But what meaning, and more importantly, what connotations does that label carry? Is settler a dirty word? Settler colonialism, of the type historically practiced by Europeans, was an unjust and often ruthless system of immigration which displaced untold numbers of Indigenous peoples from their lands on Turtle Island, a practice that the British repeated in Aotearoa, Australia, South Africa, and pretty much wherever they went. I recently saw a meme that suggested that the most celebrated holidays in the world are those that mark independence from Great Britain. Settlers are part of a larger pattern that written history has privileged as better or more advanced, suggesting that those from sedentary cultures somehow are entitled and justified in forcing nomadic peoples from their lands and claiming it as their own. So, during land acknowledgements in this room and others, think about what you are saying when you identify as a settler, with all the nuances, truth, and future responsibilities for reconciliation that term suggests. Please join me in our chalice lighting words at this time. May this flame be our light of friendship and love.
Good morning.
Good morning.
Welcome to the First Unitarian Church of Hamilton. My name is Reverend Jamie Boyce. My pronouns are she, her, and I have the great privilege of serving this congregation as its interim minister. In that role, I journey with you, the congregation, as you prepare to call your next settled minister. And that process is happening as we speak. Our service this morning will weave between the traditional fire ceremony celebrated annually at this congregation and offerings from our Unitarian Universalist Association on the theme of planting seeds for the new year. Today, we gather in body and spirit in the magic of the liquid liminal space between 2023 and 2024 to ritually recognize and release the parts of our lives that are holding us down or holding us back, release them to the transformative power of fire, and we gather to plant seeds for the future. Seeds of hope, seeds of possibility, seeds of justice, seeds of love that will blossom and bloom in 2024. In the spirit of that love, I invite you to greet each other, to greet your neighbors, perhaps place your hand on your heart and share these words. I'm glad you're here. And if you're joining online, I invite you to greet each other in the chat. I'm glad you're here. Let us rise in body and spirit for our first song, one we know and love, Enter, Rejoice, and Come In, number 361 in the gray hymnal if you're following along, but the words will appear behind me.
Good morning. Good morning. After my testimonial about pledging a few weeks ago, I was asked by several congregants to repeat it, saying the message was too important to be said only once, and it should be done in different media. Reverend Jamie suggested I speak this Sunday as part of letting go of old patterns and planting seeds to invest in the future of our church community. This morning, however, I want to share what some other congregants have told me that inspired them to raise or make their financial commitment to this church. So I'll put what I said 3 weeks ago in writing in the All Church email this week, so you all can read it if you want to. And I'll gladly talk to any of you regarding my thinking about the church financial future. But here's what others say, from Pat Dickinson. Roy and I have increased our pledge each year for several years now, and we'd already decided that we couldn't increase it this year. However, after the October 1st service provided by Elizabeth Beckett and Reverend Jamie, we decided to increase our pledge again this year. Of all the blessings we have at this stage in our lives, our church is one of the most significant. Not only because it's the support it provides for us, but because of the voice it gives us beyond ourselves into the community. As Reverend Jamie said, our faith makes a difference in the world. The combined messages of the October 1st service brought that home to us as we watched from the comfort of our living room, a blessing we received from this church, but it also allows the work and joy of this church to be made available to the larger community. From Walter Clement, I pledge financially to the church because there's a need for an open-minded, democratic church which stands up to hatred. Stands up to hatred, to Islamophobia, to homophobia, and anti-Semitism. I like the positivity and friendship in the church, which respects our first principle that values worth and dignity of each person. We need our message of love and compassion now more than ever in this time of so much violence and war. From Monica Bennett, when Canvas came around this year, I did what I do every year, avoided the church service. I don't want to listen to the hoopla, because in my mind, it's very simple. We need money to run this place, so we need to give. We need to give according to our ability. And I know that a well-resourced church is part of what will get us a good minister. I'm just practical in that way. So I increased my pledge this year because I want that for us. But there's more to it than that. I want others to have what this church has given me recently. This church provided some space and perspective and the people I needed to heal. To heal from the effects of the pandemic, to heal from my internalized sexism and classism, and to heal from hurts I've experienced inside these walls. In the past couple of years, I've watched Reverend Jamie help us create a vision of our future selves. She's helped us slow down and pay attention to what's going on around us and within us. And even though there's pain and chaos seemingly everywhere, we feel more relaxed than we used to. We're learning to be more open and less judgmental. We're better able to hear others' questions and confusion without becoming angry or defensive. Together, we're trying to figure out what it all means and what we're going to do about it. Our future selves know what oppression and abuse of power and privilege looks like and feels like, and we're learning what to do with it. So really, my increased pledge is for more than a new minister. I increase it for us, because I'm not waiting for a minister to save us. We already do that for each other. We are the ones we are waiting for. I increase my pledge because we're worth investing in. And from someone else, I donate because we and our church are in the world, this world. And this world doesn't need mere expressions of sympathy, public hand-wringing, or polite intellectual exercises that lead nowhere. This world needs our muscle, our action, our witness, and our advocacy for systemic change. I may be below the party line, but I take commitments and responsibilities of being a member of this congregation seriously. So I donate my money and time. It's part of building a beloved community and a more ethical world. And from Henry Mugga, Gail asked if Betty and I might say a word or two about a recent contribution to the congregation's financial appeal. A bit of personal history may help you understand our motivation for giving at this time. We've been fortunate over the past 55 years to have been members of congregations in Ottawa, Toronto, Montreal, and Halifax, frequently but not always accompanied by our four children, and now occasionally by them and their children. We participated in quite a few fundraisers over the years. Sometimes it was for an elevator, a new roof, or a play structure for the kids, or an affordable seniors home on the church property. Once it was for leadership for a new minister. We believe that these objectives, by far the most important, is leadership support for the congregation. All the rest can be managed, modified, or done without. In our minds and our personal experience, the core of a congregation will always be its membership. And to truly move beyond our own local concerns, we need sensitive, caring, and effective direction from a chosen, dedicated minister. And finally, from Catherine Cowley. I appreciated Gail for having the courage to both thank us for our pledges and encourage us to increase them. She inspired me to increase my pledge. My increase isn't enough to break the bank, but I really won't miss the difference. If you'd asked me to raise my pledge in 2003 when I was pretty new and only loosely connected to the congregation, I probably would have felt a bit put off. But since then, this church has become my community and a major part of my life. I regret not knowing about this place when my kids were little. Now that my kids are adults, I want the church to stay strong so they and other families had the opportunity to discover for themselves the richness of this place. I want to do what I can to make this place thrive. So thank you. Thank you to all of you, and thanks to the six congregants who wrote so thoughtfully. The diversity of ideas and perspectives speaks volumes about who we are as a congregation. If you'd like to join them in making a further financial commitment, see me after the service or check the All Church email for details of how to do it. Thank you.
We are the ones we've been waiting for. Thank you, Monica. When you arrived this morning, you were invited to stop and write down something you are releasing today on a magical piece of fire paper. Perhaps you have it in your hand. Let's wave it together for a second. If you didn't get to the table, it's right in the back. You can still time, you can stop by that side to my stage right. And if you don't have a word ready, you can just hold it. Offer it a prayer or a blessing, infuse it with that with which you are releasing today. When you arrive at the altar, you'll hold your paper up to the flame and it will poof, and disappear. That which you're releasing will be changed and transformed by the alchemy of fire. Know that we are safe this morning as we do this ritual. We have a fire blanket and plenty of jugs of water at the ready in case anything goes wrong, which it won't. Rituals of release invite us to reflect on the things that we might let go as we move through liminal spaces, spaces of creativity, renewal, change, and transformation. Perhaps at the cusp of the new year, there are places in our lives where we feel stuck and are ready for a change, places where we long for renewal and possibility to take root. Perhaps today we are releasing habits that no longer serve our lives, releasing old hurts that we're ready to move on from so relationship can grow and come alive again. Today, as the music begins, you're invited to process down the center aisle and arrive at the altar. Tim and I will be there with you, and we will release all the things we are holding today so we can be free to welcome the new year. We have spaciousness in our hearts and minds. Our online community is invited to share and explore the chat as you feel called with the things that you're releasing today. So join Tim and I at the altar for our fire communion.
Thank you.
May the fire of transformation and the alchemy of this ritual allow us to release and let go as we radically welcome 2024 into our lives, full of promise and possibility.
And thank you for not throwing the mattress behind the thing. Today's story, or Time for All Ages, is from Leela Lakshmi Peepsna Samarasinha. They, she, are a writer, older cousin, cultural and memory worker, divinator, writing teacher, space creator, low-tech survival technologist, and structural engineer of disability and transformative justice work. And today's story is titled Bridge of Flowers.
Our story today is adapted from one of my favorite authors, Leela Lakshmi Peepsna Samarasinha, and it is called The Bridge of Flowers. Now, I need you to know that this story is told in the voice of a young girl who loves her family very much. Here we go. I am quiet, and I listen a lot, and that's why I get to tell this story. So here's what happened. My mom, Soraya, is a witch. And that means that she listens to people talk and she makes potions for them out of flowers and dirt and rocks and sometimes even spit to help them with their problems. My papa, Kamau, is a scientist, and they spend a lot of their time looking at tiny pieces of moss under lots of different microscopes. When mom and papa fell in love, they planted two trees close enough together that they could be near each other, but far enough apart to have room to grow. So mom cast a spell and Bapa settled down lots of fertilizer and the two trees grew quickly and really, really tall. Now, mom and Bapa really love each other. They don't always love living together. Right, Soraya has a tendency to leave crystals and lipstick and bacon grease everywhere. And Bapa likes clean counters so that the bacon grease doesn't end up in their experiments. They fight about this sometimes. Soraya thinks that bacon grease and crystals and lipstick are part of the magic. Papa says clean counters are magical too. So eventually, Soraya and Kamau decided to live close together, but also apart. And they build houses, tree houses, in those very same trees that they planted when they fell in love. And most importantly, between the two houses, they wove a bridge of flowers so you could get back and forth whenever you wanted to. That bridge had roses and sunflowers. It had little yellow flowers whose names I don't remember. It had cactuses, one of which was the parent of my own personal cactus, Agnes. You'll hear more about her later. It was a beautiful bridge, and it allowed us to go back and forth whenever we wanted to see each other. Now, my sibling Kumar, after a while, added a skateboarding ramp to the bridge. They would go to the bridge, do an ollie, land on the ramp, go around and do the whole thing again. It kept our family woven together. Me, I stay inside often, and I journal, and I'm quiet. Sometimes outside is just too much, but late at night, when the whole world is listening, I like to sit in the middle of the bridge and breathe. Now, one day, times got really stressful in the world, and mom tried to help more and more people, and she picked more and more flowers from the bridge for her potions. And Bapa, they were doing more work to try to clean the air, and they took more mosses and lichens from the bridge. They did this work to support the community, and they picked more flowers and more mosses and more lichens. And one morning, when we went outside, we saw that they had picked too much and the bridge had collapsed. Mom and Papa started fighting about whose fault it was. Ah, we just don't have time to deal with this. And they went back to work. This is something parents do sometimes when they're stressed. But Kumar and I didn't think this was okay. Some members of the community suggested that we didn't need a bridge. After all, Soraya had a ramp, Kamau had an elevator. It wasn't as if we couldn't get to each other. But Kumar and I liked the ease of back and forth. What if I left Agnes in the wrong house? What if Kumar needed their backpack? We decided something had to be done. Now, I don't always get along with my sibling, but we talked about it and we strategized and we came up with an idea. So I went to Mom's cabinet, you know, the one she doesn't lock because she trusts us. I took some of her magical honey and her special dirt and seeds, and Kumar took lichens and mosses from Bapa's lab. And we came and we brought our hands together and we thought about what we most wanted. We closed our eyes and we wished for that to come back into being. When we opened our eyes, the bridge was back, but it didn't just connect our houses. It connected our houses and our libraries and the place where Soraya and Kamau go for organizing meetings. It connected us to the shelter and the food bank and all around the community. And the bridge was beautiful. So we went to wake up Soraya and Kamau to show them what we had done, but they were already awake. They were up late working on saving the world. But they came outside with us and saw the bridge, and it was good. So it turns out that I have magic too, even though I'm quiet. Or maybe because I'm quiet, I have magic. And it's good to live with people you love and to sometimes have enough space for yourself and for growth. And the truth is that sometimes when we least know what we're doing, it's when we are at our most magical. And that is the end of our story.
The offering that we accept each Sunday is an opportunity to recommit ourselves to this community and to our relationship with each other. When we give, we say yes to something that we value. With gifts freely given, may we say yes to the values of our faith. If you're joining us online this morning and would like to make a donation to the life of the church, there's a button on the homepage of our website which allows you to do so. And our offertory music this morning, you may sing along to, it's Gathered Here, number 389.
Gonna sing this. Good morning again. We're going to sing this at least, let's try it 3 times. Here we go.
Gathered here in the mystery of the hour. Gathered here in one strong body. Gathered here in the struggle and the power. Spirit, draw near. Gathered here in the mystery of the hour. Gathered
In support of the ministries, our ministries to one another are appreciated. Thank you.
It's my great joy to introduce our sermon speaker who is joining us through the magic of the digital world today, Reverend Dr. Sophia Betancourt. She is the president of our Unitarian Universalist Association. The Reverend Dr. Sophia Betancourt is the 10th president of the Unitarian Universalist Association. She was elected in 2023. As president of the association, she is responsible for administering staff and programs that serve more than 1,000 member congregations. She also acts as principal spokesperson and minister at large for the Unitarian Universalist Association. Reverend Dr. Sophia Betancourt's 20-year ministry has included serving as a parish minister, seminary professor, scholar, an environmental ethicist, and public theologian. Rooted in her lived identities as a queer, multiracial, Afro-Latine first-generation daughter of immigrants from Chile and Panama, Reverend Dr. Betancourt has already helped Unitarian Universalism live further into its commitments to be a radically welcoming, counter-oppressive, pluralistic faith movement. Let us welcome her talk with us this morning. My beloved housemate and chosen family, the Reverend Dr. Devorah Greenstein, has been excited about winter sowing lately. This is the practice of starting seeds outdoors in the winter months, long before most of us think about planting gardens. It's a fairly simple and practical idea. Most gardeners save plastic containers from around the house that we might otherwise recycle, and we prepare them with soil and seeds and lids, so they can protect the potential that they house through the coldest months of the year. Why do we do this? Couldn't we look at beautiful pictures and seed catalogs instead and dream of all that we might plant in the spring months? I know that that has long been my personal practice. Why would we follow what for some of us are the winter holidays by tucking tiny kernels of life into unlikely spaces? I've decided to embrace this idea of setting seed long before signs of life will be visible as a type of leaning in to the new year. How many of us, like me, have gotten into a habit of disparagement at the year's turning? I remember holiday ornaments in 2020 that had language I probably shouldn't repeat in the pulpit without good cause, woven into these beautiful snowflakes. I think we still have a small plastic dumpster with flames coming out of the top as a representation of our disparagement and dismay with the year prior. I can't remember if it was 21 or 22. Politics, pandemics, and ideologies have turned what I used to associate with fireworks and other festive celebrations into a kind of creative dismissal of all that has come to pass in the prior 12 months. Don't misunderstand me. I fully embrace the power of humor that allows us to laugh our way closer to hopefulness and possibility. We need more of that. And I'm not here to censor how we keep ourselves going in difficult times. But as often happens in my life, I can hear the echoes of my grandmother's teachings when I get a little too comfortable in how I process all the things. She used to teach me about the magic at the turning of the year, and she encouraged me to do whatever thing I most want to spend my time on or have shape the year to come just as the clock strikes midnight on December 31st. I think this is related to that tradition of kissing a loved one
right at the end of the countdown. Her encouragement reminds me that even in those most difficult years of active quarantine in the face of this ongoing pandemic, there were beautiful things to be proud of that didn't belong in the dumpster fire, for all that it made us laugh in those isolating days. A lot of that pride for me was grounded in the ways that our congregations and communities showed up for one another, showed up for the work of justice. It was grounded in my gratitude for our religious professionals, for our lay leaders and our nationals, UUA staff, as they pivoted and resourced and supported us through the unknown. Most are still recovering from that nonstop labor. Beloveds, we leaned into community care in profound ways, and I am so proud of how we continue to do so, even as many of us, though not all of us, experience fewer restrictions in our activities than we did then. We built magical bridges, the very kinds of connections and interdependence that we continue to live into together in new ways. Those bridges between and among us require tending, as does the religious witness that we hold together in the world in common cause. In the story that I shared for today's service, we learned about a family negotiating their relationships to one another in their day-to-day living. In The Bridge of Flowers by Leia Lakshmi Pyepsna Samarasinghe, she invites us to consider the beauty in how we intentionally maintain our connections to each other and invest in bringing our values to bear in the world. This unique bridge, connecting people across love, across differences, in how they approach everyday life, their belief systems, and community engagement, still allows for the creation of beauty and magic, as beauty and science and magic weave together a path that can be navigated by everyone. It keeps them connected to their children, to their people, keeps them connected even when stress seems to rob them of their joy. I probably don't need to remind you that when times were difficult and two people who loved one another profoundly gave more than they could sustainably give to maintain and support their surrounding communities, the Bridge of Flowers collapsed. Not only did it collapse, but some outside of their nuclear family discouraged them from rebuilding the bridge. Sodaya had a ramp after all, and Kamau had an elevator. It wasn't as if they could no longer reach each other with enough effort, but the love at the center of their living space was missing, and it took beauty and magic from unexpected places to reweave the interdependence that had long nurtured that family. I can imagine my grandmother telling those children to hold the seeds and the dirt and the honey and the spores together at midnight at the turning of the year. Of course, we still have time to set intentions or to weave magic for 2024, and the purposeful naming of what we most long to turn our focus toward feels important in this story. What are you most proud about from 2023? In what ways did your congregation or community encourage you to live more fully into all that you hold most precious in this past year? How did they surprise you? How did you surprise yourself? Imagine that the great potential of our liberal and liberating tradition could be nurtured through the coming months in something as simple as a reused gallon jug. Maybe there is soil in the surrounding area that is already adapted to the climate where you live, or maybe you have collected seeds from plants that have grown more savvy about their surroundings over the years. I believe that our Unitarian Universalist faith is uniquely suited to the work of justice, to showing up for the rights and freedom of all. We have everything we need to respond to these times even in moments of devastation or fear, even when bombs fall, even when ideologies of hatred and separation are lauded around the nation, even when the bridge that holds our hopes and dreams manages somehow to fall. There is a power and a hopefulness in how each one of us can set our intentions for the coming year and not wait on sun or birdsong or better weather to do the work of new growth. Right? Earth itself can cradle our dreaming as we gear up for all that is yet to come. To put those kinds of efforts at faithful living into another kind of theological context, I want to remind us of the writings of the Reverend Kenneth Patton on the temple of beauty. I consider Patton one of our modern universalist theologians whose draw to universal religion was such that he theorized the idea of a religion for one world, and he worked to bring it into being at the Charles Street Meeting House in Boston. This was Patton's commitment, the seeds he planted into the great potential of our faith. For Patton, universalism needed to be expanded. It needed to be made large enough to become an expression that included a universal humanity, universal peace, universal welfare, universal health, universal freedom, universal security, universal science and understanding. I can imagine him reweaving a bridge of flowers with these words from his 1964 book, A Religion for One World, where in trying to describe for us how we might learn to live together in community with all of humankind, he writes, "This is one world. You are one humanity. Live, therefore, in peace and till the garden of the earth. Make your days and the years of your children a glad time upon the earth." Patton believed that religion, when drawn beyond the bounds of any one culture, any one expression, or any one group of people, contained within it the possibility of bringing into being all that is most right in the world. So here, goodness, freedom, justice, understanding, kindness, consideration, and the dismantling of discrimination and prejudice all reach their most noble, compassionate, and complete dignity, grace, and power. It's a lot to expect from one universal tradition. But Patton believed that the potential for this possibility lay within reach, if only we could learn and find good ways to describe it and to teach ourselves how to recognize it in its echoes through human art and human culture. Now, I know that we have learned a great deal about the dangers of trying to define one big T truth that is available for all people, right? It's not the availability that is the issue. It's the likelihood that one dominant group's perspective will be elevated as the ultimate goal to the erasure of all other cultural and communal expressions. That is not what Patton is calling for. But still, we know, right, to hold ourselves accountable to the impact of power in those scenarios. But what I most want to hold on to from Patton's thinking is the very practical idea that liberals need good language and ideals to describe the things that we most long to bring into being. Our very pluralistic approach to Unitarian Universalism can make agreeing on shared language difficult, and without it, it's hard to collaborate with one another or to hold on to all that we hold dear. For Patton, the highest ideal that we can strive for in all of our efforts is beauty. I don't think he meant that in a temporary or frivolous or vain kind of a way. He writes that unlike goodness or truth, words that we often lift as ideals in our tradition, beauty includes the highest expression of our values. Right? He argues that there can be truth that is not beautiful, goodness that is not beautiful, but that beauty as its core is both truthful and good. And he reminds us that every expression of beauty born of our human interconnections serves as a kind of prophetic witness to what might best heal this world. Patton calls us to build temples of beauty. For me, those would probably take the form of gardens, and to fill them with everything that will preach our greatest ideals on our behalf. So what beauty do you most want to call into being in 2024? How are your congregations and your communities leaning into all that is most needed in this coming year? How are you helping to keep those bridges well tended? From the perspective that I am privileged to hold as the president of your Unitarian Universalist Association, I can tell you that there is already a lot to be proud of in our efforts in community. I hear from our field staff that care for each other far beyond the bounds and the limits of Unitarian Universalism remains the bedrock of this faith. I hear from our organizing strategy team again and again as they work with partner organizations around the country that they are thanked for the ways that you use serve as the dependable core of volunteer efforts for justice in their communities. I get to witness the ways in which our national level volunteers all across our tradition give their very best to keeping the values and the ideals of Unitarian Universalism alive in the world. And sometimes I get to sit with a few of you in small groups where I'm told again and again how this faith saves lives. Beloveds, I'm not here to tell you what seeds to plant in the coming year. I can tell you some of mine. In this shared ministry and with the wisdom of so many others by my side, I am tucking the seeds of climate justice into my winter sowing this year. Alongside it go the seeds of democratic strategy, bodily autonomy, and decriminalization. With your dedicated national staff, I get to plant seeds of accountability in ministry and congregational life, seeds of leadership development, resource production, ministry with youth and families, and greater equity among our religious professionals writ large. Together, we will continue to sow seeds that protect the most vulnerable among us, and together we will UU the vote again in this coming year. The garden of my dreams is born of the great potential that I know lives at the heart of this faith, and the love that we call into being at the center of it all is more than enough to help our dreaming bear fruit. Loves, these have been challenging times, and the beauty that we bring into being together will be enough. May 2024 shower you in blessings, and may you in turn take those blessings and share them in the world. Thank you for all that you are and for all that you will yet do. May it be so. Amen, Ashe, and blessed be.
Now that we've released the things that we have been holding on to the fire of transformation, and we've heard the uplifting and powerful message from the president of the Unitarian Universalist Association, let us reflect on the seeds we wish to plant for ourselves and for our community. What do we imagine for our future? For ourselves as individuals, for each other, for community, for this congregation, for the world. When you arrived into the building this morning, you were invited to stop and sketch an idea on an acorn. Perhaps you have your acorn in your hand. Let's wave them. If you did not get a chance to get your acorn, there's still time. Right outside these doors, you can drop by and write down what seed are you planting for this year. And then as part of this ritual, you'll be invited to this table here to my right, where you see this beautiful blue planter. And throughout the coming months, we're going to tend to the seeds planted in this blue pot, seeds of black-eyed Susans. And as we tend to them over the coming months and prepare them, this will be an offering to your next settled minister. Flowers that you have been carefully, lovingly caring for each day as you prepare to grow in relationship with your next settled minister. It is a gift of welcome and joy. So as you feel called, come forward with the seeds that you are planting, drop them at the table, and offer a spritz of life-giving water to our seeds that we are planting for the future.
Thank you.
May the seeds we plant today blossom and bloom among us, and may our hearts be full of joy and hope. Please rise and body or spirit for our final song this morning, Go Lift It Up, 1057 in the Teal Hymnal, and the words are behind me. Beloveds, with hearts lifted towards the future, may all of your dreams come true, may love and friendship surround you, and may our free faith steady you in times of uncertainty, and may you be reminded of the wisdom of the earth and the seasons of life as it teaches us to savor each moment as it arrives. May these words from Reverend Dr. Rebecca Parker hold you and keep you throughout the year ahead. In the shadowed quiet of winter's night, Earth speaks softly of her longing. Because the wild places are in tears, come, she cries to us, kneel down here on the frosty grass and feel the prayer buried in the ground. Bend your ear to my heart and listen hard. Love this world, she whispers. Distill peace from the snow and water, the cities with mercy. Weave wonder from the forest and clothe the grief with beauty. Rest in the rhythm of the turning year. Trace the bending arc, rounding the curve towards justice, and vow again to do no harm. The winter trees stand watch, haloed in the last gleams of the slanting sun. Glory sings here. Heaven echoes the call. Repeat the sounding joy. Make your life an answer. Bow, praise, rise. We extinguish our chalice, but not the fire in our hearts until we meet again here today at 5 o'clock. For our New Year's Eve party. Go in peace, beloveds, and Happy New Year.